magazine yesterday. I think it was called Interview. I said, Thursday's out, but how about never? Is never good for you?
But didn't she have problems when she was in New York?
Well, we're all allowed to indulge ourselves, aren't we? At that time, New York City was on fire. All the chandeliers were lit. One time, I went to join them at De Rigueur for a little Kilka shows, and there they were. I could see them all the way in the back of the restaurant when I walked in the front door. Charles was like a beacon, and when she was in a happy mood, it was like being with the Hope Diamond. She blazed. I sat down with them and noticed they had brought their own bottle, and I looked at the label. To my great surprise, there on the table was the largest bottle of Chanel No. 5 I have ever seen. And they were drinking it on the rocks. Now, Chanel No. 5 on the rocks, isn't that the most glamorous thing you've ever heard? Of course, everyone is known to enjoy a glass or two now and then these days, but Charles, she invented it.
She moved in next door when she was a little girl. If you want to call a mile away, next door. We live on a dairy farm, and Charles Valentine and her mother, Kara, and her sister, Lily, and her brother, Lauren, live down the road. May have been a mile, but when the Valentine kids went out to play, you really knew it. They all had small-gauge shotguns. They shot cans, they shot watermelons, old boots, tomatoes if they were a good shot, marshmallows if they were an excellent shot. Pumpkins, old tires, big pieces of paper they had drawn to look like the bad guys. China teacups. One time I remember an old and a million other things off a fence that ran around the back of their house. If you ask me, they're the ones who shot up the sign that says, "Welcome to Antler," as you drive into town. For Antler, or for anywhere, they were wild.
She carried rhinestones around in her pockets. We'd play hide and seek. I knew all her favorite hiding places because those glittery stones would fall out of her pockets, and I'd see a little pile of these sparkles. I'm 12 years older, and I'd always find her. She'd say, "How'd you find me? How did you find me?" They'd fallen out of her pockets, see? When she crouched down to hide, she couldn't hide.
One time we snuck a wine cooler from the picnic chest, and we went up and laid on a hill and sipped some of it. She kept saying the clouds looked like famous people from Hollywood or London. Famous people she knew about, but I'd never heard of. Or maybe people she just made up. So we just laid there, and I was almost asleep when she said, "Life's too hard. I just want to be a picture in a magazine."
Then was fairy tales with Charles. It was all stories and make-believe. You could say she didn't really live in town with me and Mom and Lily. Even when Charles still lived in Antler, it was forever and always about somewhere else.
Whenever Charles was around, so was Lyle Borkin. They were the exact same age, both Sagittarius, I think.
They were never apart. Lyle was always at our house, or the two of them were down to Sarah's. They were crazy, like two weird people from a circus or what have you.
Charles and Lyle had ideas I would never dream of, I'll say that. Like inconspicuous consumption or the nightclub, the bowl.
They had a little nickel and dime rock scene that revolved around a ridiculous idea called inconspicuous consumption. The original movement, this was all back in Iowa.
No, Ohio.
Yeah, that's right, in Ohio, was so exclusive that the nightclub that served as the movement's cradle existed within the confines of a bathroom stall. And they put up a velvet rope and had a little club in there, and they called it, naturally, the bowl. So this Lyle had a terrific idea. I love this. They performed songs that the crowd couldn't hear, that they whispered to each audience member one at a time.
Soldier love, soldier love, soldier love for $1.50. Soldier love for $1.50. Soldier love for $1.50. Soldier love for $1.50. Soldier love. Soldier love. sold your love for $1.50.
Nothing had ever been done like it. Not in the art world, not in cinema, not in fashion, certainly not in rock and roll. Never, never was there anything like it in the whole history of glamour.
She was going to work in the salon, too. She came from a family tree where each branch and leaf contained cosmetologists. So the night that Kara's cuts burned down, they say it was faulty wiring and some electric rollers. It was all over. The long line of beauticians came to a stop at Charles.
I guess Charles put the Valentine name up in lights and red lipstick. But before then, the history of our family could be written in bourbon. Drunken Stag, that's the family brand. But after the salon burned down, there was a little less drinking. Mother got a little money and started on a class making statues of mushrooms and deer for people's front yard. She's got the creative thing, too. And now she's got a boyfriend that works over at the air freshener factory.
One day, after the beauty salon burned down, she decided the circus was going to leave town. And overnight, the Ferris wheel, the colored lights, the grease paint, and the tent disappeared. Like that.
After the salon burned down, I discovered how much I wanted to get away from Antler, with its cloying air freshener air and its rumor-hungry, sad teenage citizens. I couldn't even drink the water in town anymore because the taste reminded me of the atmosphere. I drove around a tiny airplane creeping above the hot tops of the trees. The vapor trail crossed the sky like a line pointing out. By the time I pulled up to the only working stoplight in town, I knew I had to leave. I drove Lauren's Cadillac back to his house at the edge of town, and I strung the hammock between the twin Cadillacs. I knew then what I was going to do. I was going to be conspicuous. I was going to New York.
In a row, worshiping your sorry show. Who are you, I ask myself, to put my dreams upon your shelf? Like shrunken heads that you suspect will turn on you when you least expect. Taken months to figure out, I ask my friends and they would shout, the dude is dumb, your boy's a jerk. He may be famous, but he doesn't work. He isn't nice and he isn't smart. And that's just the start. So dump him quick, shake off the dust. It's time for you to get conspicuous.
Step aside and be our trust. Now it's time for me to be conspicuous. Step aside and be our trust. Now it's time for me to be conspicuous.
She came to the alibi. I'd never seen her in there before. And she stood in the doorway. She ordered a ginger ale and played a song on the jukebox. She talked to me about when we were kids and said I liked it here then. So so we talked for a while, and she seemed kind of far away and sad. She didn't even ask me to drive her anywhere or tell me about some crazy ideas for a band or a play or a story. After about an hour, she said, "I'm going to go." And I thought she meant she was going home, but then I realized she was never coming back.
I had always dreamed of New York, an impossible ideal I got from my mother. My mom only visited once, to see a new museum of cosmetology they were opening on Fifth Avenue. She never got over that Circle Line tour, and the fact that she was only seeing the Big Apple as an outsider. Ah, New York, like the Emerald City of Oz, everything would be perfect there. And all my childhood games and schemes, all my stories and imaginations had been placed square in a geography I'd never visited. I saw New York for the first time driving into town in a family from St. Louis's car. I gorged my eyes on the skyline, all those skyscrapers like flashy fingernails growing on the hands of a small town manicurist. It hurt my soul that first time seeing New York City that I was not yet a part of its history. And I resolved that whatever was happening in those concrete caverns and penthouses and harbors, I would not be left out.
And the next time I heard her was on that radio. A while later, she sent me one of those glass globes with an Empire State Building in it, with the glitter water that swirls around when you shake it. I put it up behind the bar in the Alibi. If her song came on the radio or the jukebox, I would look at the snow dome and think about her somewhere in the middle of New York City, happy and singing.
Then I got a call from Prada and Gucci, Versace, and Chanel, too. I got an idea. I hear hell is freezing over.
Charles Valentine at that time was tremendously famous, but everyone seems to forget that she had arrived in the city with all her worldly goods tied up in a red handkerchief just a few months before. She lasted about 10 minutes as a nobody before she was discovered in a coffee shop the very day she had hitchhiked in from her hometown in Missouri.
She was from Ohio.
Oh, Ohio. The first time I saw her was on television. She was being dragged through a sea of teenagers by her manager. There were so many flashbulbs, it was like a lightning storm. And in the center of the storm was Miss Charles Valentine, the chanteuse, the rock and roll singer.
Charles Valentine was the jewel in the Alphonse Harlan talent agency crown. She came out of nowhere from some little mud puddle in the Midwest. First time I saw her was in some dumb downtown. I had actually gone in to use the restroom, if you can imagine that. I was walking around looking for the apartment of this belly dancer somebody thought I should represent, but that's another story. But Charles Valentine, I stood for a few minutes composing myself after exiting the men's room and listening to the girl up on the stage singing. The room couldn't have had more than 15 people in it, but I thought, Madison Square Garden. A vision just came to me. I could see her name up on the marquee, letters 3 feet high. Alphonse Harlan presents. And I thought to myself, I'm gonna help her polish her act. Put the sheen on her.
How to measure fame? Well, there's one sure way. More prestigious than an Oscar, better than having your footprints in cement in front of that theater in Hollywood.
Hello, this is Charles Valentine. Don't forget to take your belongings and get a receipt from the driver. We should get together while you're in New York. Thursday's out. How about never? Is never good for you?
When I heard that, I knew I had arrived.
She could be a little distant at times. I remember once at Ooh La La, we were doing a section on Osage and Orange's new hillbilly fashions. The girls at the magazine were hiring young models from the downtown set, you know, club kids, skateboarders. But I had a flash of inspiration. I remembered Antler. I said, why hire all these CK1 hucksters that are modeling while they're cutting classes at some expensive private school in Connecticut? I mean, we'll have to draw pimples on them and black out their teeth. Let's use Charles Valentine's relatives, the real hill folk, the vraies choses. Well, I called her up, and I guess she was feeling shy about it. I explained this wonderful concept to her, the realism of it all, and she put me on hold. I waited, and I waited. And, you know, she picked up the line again. So she was sometimes shy, a little aloof, you know, but it added to her mystery.
Some nights at De Rigueur, after a few drinks, I felt like the whole glittering city was taking off, that we had released the sandbags, and Osage and Orange and I were floating over the rest of the world like a helium balloon. We had another drink then, and that's usually when our best ideas came to us.
My head grew bigger, but my brain remained the same.
When she was in New York City, that's where Antler came to her most vividly. She was haunted by visions of it. The fire really stayed with her. She seemed to almost feel guilty about leaving and not doing the manicures and such like everybody thought she would. In New York City, she kept a board that she took from the foundation of the beauty salon. I saw it when I visited New York for the fashion show. It was long and twisted like an old witch's finger.
In my opinion, I think Charles is a little crazy. I mean, look at what happened. That incident at the museum, that poor girl, the artist, minding her own business and putting on what I considered to be a very profound, moving piece of art at the museum. Charles and those fashion designers, those rag merchants, Osage and Orange, had to go and ruin a perfect aesthetic experience. I mean, I was having a great time and I hear this crash. I thought a taxi cab had jumped the curb and crashed through the window.
New York City. It's only three words, each word so succinct. And no matter how old it gets, there's always new at the beginning. And what a place, so filled with interesting people and great ideas. One time, Osage and Orange took me to the Guggenheim Museum to see an artwork by Alicia Boobcraft. There was a line of serious intellectuals waiting to get in. They stood around outside smoking cigarettes and talking about what they had just seen. Inside, there were a dozen gorgeous gals, some wearing coochie bikinis and some just as naked as the day they were born. It was far out, some whispered. Fabulous, said a few. A feminist manifesto, one guy said. Others, they just stood and stared. Me, I was thinking. They were so still and so tall, those lovely art workers, swaying slightly like blades of grass on a still summer day. But it seemed to be missing something, and I decided that something was me. Osage, Orange, and I thought fast. We zipped back to their design atelier and picked out a pair of teetering heels and something revealing. But my costume had an extra accessory. I grabbed a bat from the annual fashion designer softball game and back we went for my little performance. Everyone was still inside when I began to sound out my own feminist manifesto. They could hear me knocking, all right. But it seems that some forms of feminism are more appreciated than others.
Charles didn't want to be a cosmetologist. That was plain from the beginning. I can see it. I can understand. It's not like I come from a long line of janitors or maintenance engineers. There's no legacy. I just got a job. But hell, I'm happy with what I do. Ain't nobody gonna come and have me on the cover of magazines or on TV. And I was on When Instinct Takes Over. I had developed a new moose call that I whittled from an old piney branch I found. I was gonna use it with my buddy Yupel next time we were on a moose hunt. Yupel and I went out to the woods and he took off over a little hill. I set to work blowing on that call, and a moose come up out of nowhere with his head kind of turned to the side. He was kind of like, I don't know, smiling at me. Next thing you know, the moose come up behind me, tried to put his hooves up on my back. Now, I don't know what the call was saying to that moose, but I had in mind. Guys at work called me Moose for a while, but a couple trips out to the parking lot, I set things straight with the fellas.
She was unlike anyone. There were beautiful women, and there were beautiful women who could sing, and then there was Charles. After a while, she began to suspect that nobody gave a damn what she wrote about or what she sang about, and that the real concern of the record companies was that when the photos were printed in Rotate magazine, her nose wasn't shiny. I saw footage of one of her concerts, and she did the most delightful thing. The energy of the crowd had a crescendo. The young girls were dressed just like her, reaching their arms out and calling out her name. And then, with the tears trickling down the faces of her fans, she removed her compact from God knows where in her tight dress and pat, pat, a little cloud of dust arose. She powdered her nose as if she didn't give a damn. Such an insouciant gesture.
There's a point where if you become more and more glamorous, you will become transparent and then invisible. People won't see you or hear you. You'll just be a mirage. I began to believe I could have been an empty dress singing. I would be up on the stage singing a song that was so mean and so true. But a strange thing happened. I would be under the spotlight and I could feel myself being bleached to whiteness. Singing is never good for you for the thousandth time. I began to materialize and dematerialize right there on stage. And I realized that all those people in the audience knew about this disappearing, and it dawned on me. That's what they came for, to watch me disappear.
Now, I am used to dealing with models, and I know this is a stereotype, but let's not kid ourselves. If they brought the shoot, they would be holding it upside down while they pretended to read it. But Charles, while we were setting up her photo session, pulled out a notebook in which she scribbled with a most serious expression on her face. I thought, how adorable, she has a diary. But she began to publish strange, lovely little stories here and there. And do you know, she could really write.
When she left, I think I missed her the most. Me and Sarah, the pretty girl who works at the Alibi Lounge. I talked to Charles on the payphone downtown every Wednesday night.
The history of Charles Valentine is just a footnote to the whole history of glamour. Glamour is great, it's bewitching. Do you know the definition? It comes from the word grammar. Grammar a long time ago meant a book of spells, and back then reading and writing used to seem like magic. Glamour has that power too, like a spell or a really interesting. One where anything could happen and you can't wait to see how it turns out.
Her life is a tremendous story. One that people apparently never tire of hearing. We at Ooh La La magazine have eased off a little now that she's in seclusion. But I remember every month for a couple of years we'd run a little something on her. She was spotted walking a little rabbit on a leash around Central Park. We ran it. She had her hair streaked fuchsia. We ran it. She had started a trend for wearing high heels in the bath. We were there.
Even the building that houses Ooh La La's office is like a big marble mausoleum. I'm telling you, there's evil in them halls. And when they got their hands on Charlie, it was a disaster. They dressed her up like a spooky effigy, a doll. What about talent, my friends? What about the songs? You can't open a magazine and hear them. Dresses and clothes, is that what makes somebody glamorous? Hoodoo. I can't say I was unhappy when the offices of Ooh La La caught fire. I mean, nobody was hurt, and they had to move Grace all the way across the pond to France. It's a good place for her.
Everybody else in rock and roll had used up the good lines, and by the time I got there, it was too late. Even New York City, my teenage Shangri-La, turned out to be a magic carpet ride through everything that ever entranced me from a distance and disgusted me up close. I loved New York most when I took a step back from it, the way that antler was always with me when I was farthest away from home. I would be sitting in de rigueur on the Upper East Side when the image of the sign that advertised the air freshener factory back home, the one shaped like a pine tree that emitted little gusts of artificial pine-scented air, would enter my head so vividly that I might as well have been right there, waiting in the parking lot with Mom for her boyfriend to finish his shift. I guess that's why I had to write about Antler, to get the sight of it out of my head.
In a place like Antler, you take beauty where you can find it, whether it's taking delight in some new lipsticks from the dime store, admiring statues of plastic chickens in the front yard of a ghastly subdivision home, or finding real meaning in the cheap sentiments of a teenage pop star.
Grace Greenberg is a crone. What does she know from glamour? She's a hag at the gates of beauty.
For the first
Every
year
time I
of the
came
movement,
near one of the girls, one of the models, or the other
the
little
song.
Singers at Charles
None
was being
had been
photographed
recorded.
With, Miss Greenberg
kids would, get
would have
at
me
the
removed
bowl,
from the shoot.
And Lyle Borgen
I've been ejected
would
from parties
the
by
song
goons
to
and
everyone in the
suits.
Audience
I've been tossed down a flight of
we
stairs
all know
by
the
bodyguards.
Now,
These
but
things
while it lasted,
I can handle.
They had a
but
real
Grace,
salt culture for the first time in years that nobody could touch. Nothing had ever been done.
I think it was at this time that I began to feel it. That I'd memorized so much, I'd drunk so much expensive perfume, I'd been hemmed in by those buildings so much, I knew so many dead facts about fashion and music, I'd had my picture everywhere and talked about whatever was supposed to be inside my brain, that by then, my own face and the inside of my head became tiresome to me.
And then there's Osage and Orange. Their clothes are so fucking ugly. I mean, they based an entire line of clothing around death, a funeral fashion show. Mourning the corpse of beauty, and they killed it.
Eventually, Charles Valentine appeared on the cover of This Week magazine. Now, if This Week magazine is reporting on something that's supposed to be fashionable, you know that it's not fashionable anymore. It's been sullied by the smudgy hands of the masses, and it is O-V-E-R.
Mind you, we have other stars, some of them destined to be huge. We have this new kid, Blanky Smells Good.
Well, come in. a place in the distant future.
Blanky smells good. I've got my eye on that kid. Up around the same time I started as Charles's manager. This Blanky rides around a little BMX bicycle with two turntables strapped to the side. He has a camouflage print blanket wrapped around his neck all the time, hence the name. He's 12 years old, very young, but still a little old for a Blanky. Charles has a problem with him. Apparently, this kid thinks rock and roll is old-timers music. He called Charlie a nostalgia act. He's not the star Charlie was, is, but he has his fans. Yeah. Life, and I still can't believe she would want to give it up. In this town, people spend their lives trying to get what she had, and she decided to turn her back on it. She had dreamed of glamour her whole childhood out there in Kansas, the story goes, and not after even a year she tosses it away. Here in the city, she had two cellular phones. She got 37 faxes a day. I mean, you're nobody till somebody pages you, right? How could she go sit out on some dusty farm where nobody remembers she exists?
Charles met us at the airport and she jumped up into my arms wearing a tired expression on her face. She was too skinny and just sat in my mother's house staring out the window when she came back to Antler. But within a couple weeks, she was eating potato chips by the bag and had a bunch of new plans. She sat up late typing at Mom's. She'd come over to my place, and we would sit on the porch at night in a little circle of light from an old lamp I have out there and read from the story she'd tucked. The writing still sounded like singing. Very nice.
On Christmas Eve, my father takes me out in the truck, and we drive past all the holiday displays in Antler. Dad says the big subdivision around the lake has the best, the houses with the reindeer on the roof and other sophisticated displays. But I always make him take me out to the farmhouses way out from downtown, where the lights don't have to compete like in the extra-decorated neighborhoods. We passed Charles's house, and someone had tossed up a string of lights in the apple tree by their front porch. It was in the top branches, like it had just fallen from the sky. I'd driven by there every day that December, and those lights weren't there until that night. I knew only one person would climb up on a ladder in the wind and the freezing cold just to get a string of lights up before Christmas was over. It sounds weird, but when I saw that strand of orange lights, that's how I knew Charles Valentine was back.
But it turns out that even though her life was absolutely different than anyone had planned it to be, I still believe that in a way, she followed her mother's trade. After all, they both adhered to the most all-American pursuits. Cosmetology and rock and roll are about making oneself over, recreating oneself, starting with the average and making it marvelous.
Grace said the same things over and over again, but she had such a manner as to make you believe she was saying them for the first time. It was all the best, the most beautiful, and especially, there was never anything like it in the whole history of glamour. But what is the history of glamour? Who are its historians? I guess those for whom glamour and its spellcasting abilities are most important, the ones who really need its transformative powers the most. Charles Valentine traveled a long distance in a short time, and along the way I learned do about it? And what do I think of glamour now that I'm a grammar girl typing at least 2,000 words a day? I used to think that glamour was completely necessary. But now what do I think I need? I still need a compact and a lipstick, maybe. Someone to sit on the porch with me in the summer. An ability to recognize if I'm caught in the wrong story or the story someone else wants me to inhabit. And as for advice, I found, when absolutely necessary, a pack of matches can really change your life.